According to the Global Burden of Disease study, on a worldwide basis, depression ranks fourth as a cause of disability and early death.
A new study recorded that over 19 million American adults are living with major depression.
That's more than 15 times the amount of Americans living with HIV.
And over 6 million more than diagnosed cancer patients.
1 in 4 teens will experience depression
before they graduate high school.
1 in 5 U.S. combat veterans suffered or are suffering from PTSD,
which if untreated can lead to major depression.
15% of new moms in America will experience a severe form of depression,
known as postpartum depression.
79% of people who have been diagnosed with depression have been discriminated because of their disorder.
As many as 15% of those who suffer from some form of depression take their lives each year.
And approximately 80% of people battling depression are not receiving treatment.
MRIs have shown that the brain of a person with depression
looks different
compared to the brain of a person who has never had it.
The areas of the brain that deal with thinking, sleep, mood, appetite, and behavior do not appear to function normally.
There are also indications that neurotransmitters
appear to be out of balance.
Neurotransmitters are chemicals that our brain cells use to communicate.
However, imaging technology has not revealed what may cause the depression to occur.
Depression does not discriminate.
If you or someone you know is suffering from depression,
please be brave enough to seek help.
I had a dream the other night about how we only get one life. Woke me up right after two. I stayed awake and stared at you so I wouldn't lose my mind. And I had the week that came from hell. And yes, I know that you could tell. But you're like the net under the ledge. When I go flying off the edge, you go flying off as well. And if you only die once, I wanna die with you. Got something I need. In this world full of people, there's one killing me. And if we only die once, I wanna die with you. I drank too much. Yeah, call it our temporary crutch. Yeah, with broken words I tried to say, honey, don't you be afraid. If we got nothing, we got us.
The Centers for Disease Control says roughly 1 in 10 Americans today is depressed. The land of opportunity
depression
apparently offering a lot of opportunity.
Recognized
for misery. Several studies claim rates of depression are 3 times more
likely to have depression.
We're talking something like 27 million Americans?
Yes.
I think depression feels like you're in a crowded room, screaming at the top of your lungs, and no one even bothers to look up.
I've always said, like, it's when you're so emotionally drained and exhausted and tired that you rather start feeling physical pain to get your mind off of it.
Like, you feel confused, almost like you're in another world, and try to get out of it, but it's not as easy as it. Sometimes you just can't.
It makes you feel like worse than the situation is and brings you down a lot.
I have these negative thoughts and they consume my brain to a point where it won't allow a positive outlook.
Nothing you ever do is good enough. Constantly, like, there's something in your head saying, like, something's wrong with you, something's wrong with you.
I'm not talking about, like, you're having a bad day and you feel stuck kind of feeling. I'm talking about the internal sadness that doesn't go away at all. It affects every aspect of your life, your relationships, your friendships, your mood, your behavior, everything. Stephen King once said, monsters are real and ghosts are real too. They live inside us and sometimes they win.
Started around like 16. I was bullied for my weight.
What was the hardest part?
Like how I see myself. It's a bad image.
When I was 15, like now, basically throughout, I mean, you deal with that every day. It just, one day I woke up and I just felt different. And like, it wasn't bad at first. Like I could still continue with moving in life. And then as days went on, I just, every morning it progressed and got worse. And then it just like took over me. But hey, I didn't want to get up. I didn't go to school my senior year because of it. Like I got like homeschooled and stuff. I just couldn't.
I like hit rock bottom when I had a miscarriage. Personally, like I needed outside help. And I never got that until I had to admit myself, like, okay, I have a problem. I would drink. And I would drink until I blacked out. And the way I was thinking, I'd just be like, oh, well, I was happy for a couple of hours and I wasn't upset and I wasn't crying. There were so many nights where I would like grab a knife and I'd close my eyes and I'd put it on my skin.
Does it get better every day? Or?
I think time healed all. And some days are better than others, but I'm slowly getting to where I want to be. Each day is a little better, unless I have like, you know, once it's Mother's Day, then I have like a Carter episode, or it's Carter's birthday, then I'll have another episode.
Joe's depression got really bad, to the point where at parties he would abuse alcohol, and then it was like a switch that would switch on, and he'd be happy one second, and then one second he'd go, and it'd just be like the world was crumbling around him. And when he was drunk, he would say how nobody loved him and nobody cared about him and how much he wanted to hurt himself and just not be here anymore. And it hurt from like a friend's aspect to see him going through that. And that was when, I think that was when everyone started noticing that something was wrong.
Well, I know Joe like the back of my hand, especially at that moment when he said that, I knew something was wrong. And then it clicked in my head then that what he was saying, although he was in a state of mind in which he didn't remember any of it, was coming from a dark place.
He'd spend days in bed, and then when we actually did go out, it was so hard to get him to eat. At one point in time, I had to physically like keep him in place and tell him we weren't leaving the restaurant until he finished a bowl of rice. It was awful and scary.
There was a point in my life where I physically could not get out of bed, no matter how much I tried, no matter what I did. So I made it very difficult for people to ever realize what I was going through. It was a very dark point in my life that I thought was nearing an end. I tried finding the one thing that I couldn't find within myself, and that was peace. On April 3rd, 2011, I will remember this conversation for the rest of my life, but I called a cousin up at 2:36 a.m. and told him that I did not want to live this life anymore, and this life was not for me, and that I was done fighting this. And he said, don't go, because if you go, then I'll go, and we can't do that to our mothers. After that night, I realized that there's a piece of me that I will never get back after all of this. There I was, suicidal, underweight, sick, and bitter. I look at old photographs and see more than a younger version of me. I see a person that I will never come to know again after all of this. I think at this point in my life, I'm trying to accept the fact that the person who I was before depression, I will never know again. May of 2011, I started therapy. I was seeing a therapist because I was very bitter, and I took my anger out on my family and my friends. And although I didn't think I needed help, I knew I had a responsibility to all of them, all the people that I hurt, to be the best person I could possibly be. And I have younger cousins who I hope they look up to me and I'm their role model. And I definitely did not want to be someone who was suicidal, who was depressed. I didn't want them to look up to someone like that. After my first few sessions, I started to look at myself in the mirror every morning and ask myself, if today was the last day of my life, would I want to do what I'm about to do today? And whenever the answer has been no for too many times in a row, I knew that I had to change something. And that's all. That's the main key in recovery or living a healthier life, is you have to make changes. And you have, whether it's letting go of negative people, or it's finding a hobby, or getting a totally new haircut, or just having the courage to start over again. I think one of the hardest points in my battle was realizing that I needed help, that I couldn't do it alone anymore. I believe asking for help isn't a sign of weakness at all. I believe it's an expression of strength. Sometimes we don't have it all together, and we're not always going to be okay on our own. Sometimes we do need that extra help. Depression, I've learned, doesn't take the blame for what happens. Whatever you do when you're depressed, it does not take the blame for you. You have to take the blame for yourself. And unfortunately, that's the sad thing. Depression walks into your life, takes over, and just leaves you to pick up the pieces. But I'm thankful every day that I do have the opportunities to pick up the pieces. I think one of the greatest lessons I've learned this year is that we are never actually alone. No matter how much we make ourselves believe it, we aren't. There is someone out there, many out there, who want you to win and who love you and want the best for you. You're never alone in your fight. But there comes a moment where you have to tell yourself, what is in front of me or what I'm going through, I don't deserve. You realize you really do have a shot at happiness and that you deserve it just like everyone else. You realize that you are the hero to your own story. You have fire. You have depression to fight. This is your life, not depression's. I have to tell you that I'm not 100% okay. I'm not fixed. And it's going to be a battle every day to eat more, to go to bed, to get up after going to bed. But I want you to know in the sincerest way possible that I'm going to have a beautiful life. I'm going to be happy because I'm the hero of this story. Today may feel like you have nothing else to give, but someday soon, you're going to be the world to someone. You're going to pour your love into the most beautiful replicas of you. You'll grow, and you'll grow. With every scar and battle won and lost, you'll grow. I guess I made this because I want you to know, no matter who you are, that it's possible. It's possible to live and not to just exist. I believe there's a huge difference between those two words. Life, growing up, is a journey and race all in one. A beautiful one if you let it. But this race and this pursuit of contentment is something I can be both excited and completely unprepared for. I can see the finish line. I can hear the cannons of success. And I can feel the days of tears, blood, and sweat drying before me. To anyone out there who's told that they're less than by their churches, by their families, by their peers, by the world, or even by the monsters you fight behind closed doors, you are amazing. Beautiful creations you deserve to live. Things are going to get better. Things are going to get beautiful. And you should be alive to see it.
I just didn't think I was going to get better, and I obviously am better. And you just got to be patient.
I'm here. I'm living proof of it, that I've been through it and try as hard as you can, so I'll never give up.
Joe is going to go far, and I don't think that he'll let depression define him. And I think that he'll let his heart guide him. I swear I live.
We need to know that there are people who want to help, who will help, and you can live your life without the cloud. Joe's gonna stay fabulous. He's gonna get the hell out of Rhode Island and experience different things in different states and come back and tell us all. I swear I
don't believe what people tell you, believe yourself. I saw something